I will keep it brief. I'm just going to walk through some of the highlights in the report. We publish reports every 6 months that sort of summarise, update how we're tracking what's going on in the Parliament. And I'm going to talk about the following four activities. Who's on the winning side most? The coalition patterns between the groups, how cohesive the groups are internally, and what we found about some other activities, reports, the questions, and so on. The analysis here is based on all of the recorded, all the roll call votes in the first 18 months of this Parliament, so up to the end of December 2010, which is 1,351. I should point out, of course, that not all votes in the Parliament are by roll call. Roll calls are requested, so it's a sort of health warning. So if you look at any individual vote, you could perhaps get a skewed picture. But if you, I think if you aggregate across a large number of votes, which is what we do in this report, I think it does give you a relatively good picture of what goes on inside the Parliament. In terms of who's on the winning side most, this compares the blue bars as the previous Parliament, EP6, with the red bars the first 18 months of this Parliament. And you can see that actually the Liberal group in the middle of the Parliament is on wins more votes in roll call votes than the EPP, even though the EPP are the largest vote, largest group. So what we see here is that the Liberal group, as we found previously, has carried on in this position of being the kingmaker in certain votes in the Parliament. But in general, though, you can see that these three groups in the middle of the Parliament dominate the Parliament. It's a pretty centrist Parliament with coalitions shifting from left to right, as I'm going to show you. When looking at coalition patterns, here you can see the black bar here is the grand coalition of those three parties when they vote together. The yellow bar there is with the EPP and the Socialists voting together against the Liberals, with the Liberals against them. The blue bar there is the Socialists with the Liberals against the EPP, and then the red bar is ALDE, the Liberals with the EPP. So you, basically the black bars there show the grand coalition. You get a grand coalition about 60% of the time in the Parliament, and you get left-right splits around 35% of the time on average. But it varies across issue areas. So you can see here we've got some issue areas we've highlighted there. So civil liberties, justice, home affairs has become more left-right. Constitutional and inter-institutional affairs has become more grand coalition. And you can see on the last column there, environment and public health always was a lot of splits on left-right and increasingly so. So you see the grand coalition forming about less than 40% of the time in that area, and a left-right split in a majority of times. We've got some examples in the report of the votes, and you can just see from, if you go to our website and look at the electronic version of the report, you can click straight onto the votes as they're reported on our website from these examples. So one of the examples is the vote on the 17th of June on the European Economic Governance Package, and here you can see the Grand Coalition in operation, a clear majority in favour, a very large majority, with the three groups in the middle of the Parliament, the Socialists, Liberals and EPP, all voting together, also with the Greens backing them. And you can see the radical left on the left, the GUI on the left, and the British Conservatives on the right voting against the package. So this is a clear example of the sort of grand coalition vote. What you can see that's different to the another example here, I've got the date here, it was in November 2010 on the anti-counterfeiting trade agreement. Here you can see a left-right split with the right winning by a slim majority against a motion being proposed by the left, largely because of some breakaways from the Socialists and the Liberals to support the right. So here was an issue that was a, you can see how there's a relationship between the coalitions that form and how cohesive the parties are. Another example to illustrate this is the Amendment 12 on the maternity leave, which was the amendment that got most attention in the press, which was the amendment to extend maternity leave to 20 weeks. And here, again, you saw broadly a left-right split, but a big split within the EPP and a smaller split within the Liberals, and the left winning on this issue largely because of the split within the EPP. So had the EPP been cohesive on that question, for example, then the right would have won against the left and defeated that amendment. In terms of cohesion of the groups, so this is a cohesion score that we use, and it's a standard score used in US Congress and other parliaments. It's a scale that goes from 0 to 1. So if in these are 6 month periods from the whole of the previous parliament and the first 3 6 month periods from this parliament. And so if in one of those periods, in all the votes in that period, if all of the group all the members of a group voted all the same way in every single one of those votes, you score one. If they were split down the middle in every single one of those votes, they would score zero. As a baseline comparison, Democrats and Republicans in the US Congress are about 0.8. Parties in national parliaments like the House of Commons or the Bundestag score about 0.95 in their cohesion scores. So you can see how the trend across time has carried on being relatively high and growing slightly, and is particularly high for the biggest groups in the parliament, Socialist, CPP, and grown significantly for the Greens, interestingly, in this parliament relative to the previous parliament. But on average, you know, this is very, very high levels of party line voting in the European Parliament. If you want to predict how an MEP votes, you only need to ask one question: which group do you belong to? And if they belong, you can predict how they vote 80% of the time just knowing which group they belong to. You don't need to know what member state they come from. At the back of the report, we have a little kind of cut out and stick up on your wall summary data table that we can update every 6 months. And this is a sort of to give you some of the ideas of the information that we have on the website, and also that we will keep updated every 6 months for you. So we have in the appendix there on two bits of information about the winning side. So the percentage of times the EPP won by issue area, and the percentage of times that the EPP won more. So this is the percentage of times EPP won compared to the percentage of times the Socialists won. So you can see the table here is sorted by that second column there, and you can see how gender equality issues, the Socialists is winning 20, Socialists are winning 20% more times than the EPP, whereas on economic and monetary affairs, the EPP are winning 30% more than the Socialists are. Then the third column there is the percentage of a left-right split as opposed to a grand coalition. And you can see down the bottom there, gender equality, civil liberties, environment, public health, development. You can see there the issues where you see mostly left-right splits, high levels of left-right splits, and more left-right splits than grand coalitions. And then the last three columns, you can see the cohesion scores in those sub-areas of the votes. Some interesting things to note there. The highlighted in the table here on the slide are all the areas where cohesion is less than 90%. What's interesting is you can see there gender equality, EPP cohesion down to 74%. Agriculture is interesting, particularly when you think about the powers of the parliament now under the common agricultural policy as a result of Lisbon. You can see that's one of the lowest areas of cohesion for all of the three main political groups. So some voting along national lines on agricultural issues, which you'd expect. But a lot of the more socioeconomic, market regulation type questions, and also civil liberties and environment standards, you can see growing left-right politics inside the parliament and high levels of party cohesion. So the parliament, the European Parliament, is much like many other parliaments. We also have in the report other data. One of the bits of information we have on our website that attracts a lot of press and attracts a lot of response from individual MEPs claiming we've got it wrong and they did actually attend on such and such date, is the attendance data. And we are very, very careful in responding to every single comment by every MEP and clarification and being very careful about how we correct this. And our data is probably more accurate in that sense than some of the data actually on the European Parliament's website on this stuff. So here is attendance across in each of the 6 month periods for each of the groups. The average attendance in the parliament is now 88%, which is a lot higher than in a lot of national parliaments in Europe. So we can bust some myths that some of the domestic press have about MEPs and their activities. And you can see how, interestingly, in the first semester of this parliament, the first 6 months, attendance was on average higher, the sort of novelty factor, I guess. It's leveled off a bit, but still it is high, and it's high for all groups, but it's particularly high for the two biggest groups in the parliament who are running most of the business in the parliament. So up around 90% on average. Other information we have in the report relate to things like questions, speeches, and the number of reports where an MEP proposed amendments to the report. So it's a measure of the sort of legislative activity of the MEPs. So you can see here, this is questions per MEP, speeches per MEP, and amended reports per MEP. And you can see how the groups in the center are less active in their questions and their speeches than the groups on the extremes. And you can see how the radical left and the anti-Europeans, the EFD group, are using questions and speeches because they don't have so much access to the agenda in terms of report writing. And there you can see draft reports and opinions, again, that shows that. What's interesting here is you can see how the ALDE are probably slightly overrepresented as a proportion of, in terms of their activity in the parliament, in terms of report writing. But you can see the Greens, interestingly enough, on the left there. In proportion to how many MEPs they have in the parliament, you can see the Greens writing a lot of reports relative to their size in the European Parliament, a lot of opinions. Here's the attendance data by member state, which, of course, a lot of people like to look at, but there's not a huge amount of variance here. The UK British MEPs have slightly lower attendance than some of the others, and the Austrians have slightly higher attendance, but there's no really systematic pattern here you can point to, I think. Distance from Brussels is not a predictor. Questions per MEP. Interestingly, the Irish are very active in their questions. That may have something to do with the way the Irish MEPs are elected in relatively small constituencies with single transferable vote, a very candidate-based electoral system. The Irish MEPs are very visible in election campaigns and very active in terms of in their own websites and putting on the websites their own activities in the Parliament. And we get a lot of feedback from Irish MEPs to our website. Speeches, the Portuguese tend to be the most verbose for some reason. But anyway, we can flip on down. Let me punchline. Summary. As in previous parliaments, the European Parliament is primarily a party political parliament where voting is along party lines, not national lines. I keep hammering this home to people, and I still am amazed when journalists phone me up and they are amazed that they've never heard this before. Maybe I'm so vain that I think they should have read my stuff before, but anyway, they haven't. Voting on party lines is slightly higher in this parliament than it was in the previous parliament. EPP is the largest group, but doesn't always get its own way. And it can lose votes if there's a breakdown along left-right lines and, as is the case in some policy areas, where the cohesion of that group breaks down with some splits, with some of the MEPs voting with the socialists and the liberals on the left, as we saw on the maternity leave directive. Coalition patterns shift issue by issue. The European Parliament is much like US Congress in that coalitions on any issue have to be built issue by issue. So it's not like national parliaments where there's an inbuilt government majority that just whips them to support it. Sometimes you get centre-left majority, sometimes you get a centre-right majority, sometimes you get a grand coalition. It can even shift within directives, amendment by amendment. So a few final points. One on transparency. As I said, not all votes in the European Parliament are by roll call vote. Some really significant and important things are not by roll call vote. In particular, probably the single most important vote that has taken place in this Parliament so far, the vote on the SWIFT package, SWIFT agreement, where the Parliament threw out the SWIFT agreement, was not by roll call vote. We were inundated with hits on our website and emails saying, why haven't you recorded the roll call vote? And we had to kind of explain very carefully that it's not our fault it wasn't by a roll call vote. And I think it's, for issues like this, it's very difficult to explain to citizens or interest groups or the media, why isn't this a recorded vote? Why can't I see how my MEP voted on such an important issue, such a significant issue? And particularly the national media, who'd often like, this is an opportunity for them to report on what happened inside the parliament. And all they can report on is up or down. They can't report on actually what happened. So I would really urge the MEPs that on all major issues, and particularly on final votes, on all major issues in the parliament, they really should be by roll call. Finally, as Sarah noted, we're going to carry on tracking what goes on in the parliament, and we're building a part of the website to do the same with the council. It's a slower process. It's very difficult prizing open information from the council, particularly things like the sponsorship of amendments and the co-sponsorship of amendments in the council, which they say are available on their website. We can't find them, and if we can't find them, nobody can find them. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Simon. Excellent.